Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It is good to be in the house of God. And it's so good that you are able to join us. All of our online viewers, members, guests, thank you for taking the time out to spend this evening with us as we go into God's word. And it's so valuable and so precious to hear God's word. We need God's word in this day and time like never before. And because of people not hearing it and doing it, that's why we see the world in the condition that it's in right now. We see so much violence, hatred, just lack of care for humankind, just death all around us, where people are not responding in obedience to God's word. So I thank God that you're here and that you have taken time out to hear God's word. And we want you to have a mind to put it into practice, to do it. Amen. So we are going to go into a word of prayer. If you would bow your heads with me. Father God, we're grateful for this opportunity, dear God, to come before you, to learn of you. God, to be taught of you, not about or by a man to teach man's ways, but you do use men, but it's not man's ideas. It's your word only. God, we pray, God, that you give us an understanding. God, that you speak to our hearts, illuminate our minds, cause us, God, to have, God, an understanding of what your word is telling us so we can conduct our lives, God, according to your word. Let us not be ignorant. Let us search, God, for the truth that we might know how to live and how to walk and to please you. Strengthen each person. And God, minister to their need, their condition, whether there be a physical need, they're sick in their body, or whether there is a spiritual need, they're in sin, or God, they are confused, they don't know which way to go. God, they're hurting, they're in pain because of a heartbreak. Oh God, we pray, God, that you would touch them, that you would go through the airwaves, God, and minister to their needs. And God, give them the faith and the vision, God, to go after you, to please you, dear God, the faith to follow you. Oh God, strengthen every person, God, this night. And God, we pray that you would save the sinner. Oh God, give understanding and hope, God, to every person, God, that is viewing. God, meet every person's need. God, we thank you. We honor you. And God, I pray that you would take control of me, that only words that are from you would be spoken with such clarity, God, that the children can understand. God, I can do nothing on my own. God, the people need you. God, glorify your son. God, that I can glorify you, but I can't glorify you on my own. I can do nothing apart from you. Strengthen me. Anoint me, God. Inspire me. Breathe upon me. Take full control of this body, my mind, God. Use it for your glory. God, that the people might know, God, what you expect of us about how we should live, how we should treat one another, how we should treat people that take advantage of us, how we should treat people that are our enemies. You tell us to love them, to do good to them. God, that's what your word says. Let us go by what your word says only and not what we feel. God, we thank you and we appreciate you and we give you all the glory and the honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. We only want God's word, not what is popular, not people getting together to vote, or some 8 or 10 judges overturn something. We want to go by what God says. Don't you know that just like we have Supreme Court judges, God has judges also. He has servants that he puts in the midst of the people, among them, to judge them or to show them what's right and wrong in the eyesight of God. That's what we need. And at one time, the judges, even in, like we have our judges today, like they determine our laws. Well, at one time, the judges used God's word. God had judges in the book of Judges to judge the people. And that's what we need today. We need God's word. We don't need what's popular. We need men and women of God that live the word of God so they can share with others so they can know what is acceptable to God. But that's why it's important to please God, to live for him. When you do that, God gives you understanding of his word. But if you try to take his word and you don't live by it, you just want to use it for your own profit or for your own gain, God will hide it from you. You won't understand it. And people that really want God, they'll be able to see that this person is not truly of God. It won't, because the Bible says, Jesus said, my sheep know my voice. They follow not the voice of strangers. So as Chief was even speaking on this past Sunday, he spoke about the sheep and the goats. He spoke about how sheep, they might be getting ready to eat something, but they hear the voice of their shepherd. Though they were getting ready to eat that, they'll stop and go and move toward the voice of their shepherd. That's what sheep do. You know if you're a sheep or if you're a goat. He spoke about how the goat will get ready to eat something and they hear that voice, so judge you. Because see, every chief is not always at your house. He's not, he can't tell whether you, what you did with all your money. He is not with you all the time. How you treat your wife or your husband, how you treat your neighbor, or how you acted on the freeway when somebody cut you off. He is not always there, but God is. And you're supposed to study God's word and judge yourself. And you know to know whether you're in the faith or not. Judge your own heart. How you talked and how you responded when somebody says something that displeased you, that hurt you. And they, I'm not saying what they said to you was right, but you're supposed to obey God regardless of what they say to you. It doesn't matter what someone says or does to you to justify you violating God's word. You're to obey God's word regardless of what someone does to you. Again, sheep will respond to the voice of their shepherd. If Jesus is your Lord, if he is your boss, if he is your shepherd, you'll respond to his word and not how you feel. I want to be a sheep, not just in church. I want to be a sheep when I'm by myself, when thoughts come to my mind that are not pleasing in the sight of God. I still want to be a sheep when I'm on vacation, if I happen to go out of town, if I have to happen to be in a hotel, and what I put on the channel, I still want to be a sheep. And you can be a sheep, or you can be a goat. I can choose to be a goat, but I don't want to be a goat. The goat, he's going to tell them to get on the left. So I want to be on that right side. Amen. Hallelujah. So God wants to, he wants to guide us. He wants to govern our lives. And when God governs your life, it's going to be for your benefit. It's not going to be for your detriment, but it's going to be for your benefit. Hallelujah. God wants what's best for you. So I want to be on that right side. Hallelujah. So Chief ministered this Sunday with the message called "The Priest's Lips Should Keep Knowledge." Why do the priest's lips need knowledge? So they can instruct God's people. You're not to go to get knowledge off of Google, Facebook. Let me Google what the Bible says about such and such. Because the person that did the Google, that programmed it, they don't understand, always understand God's word. The Bible says, know them that labor among you. You don't know them. You don't know their life. You might hear a preacher on television, on the radio. They might say something, a few scriptures in context, but use some other ones out of context. See, you got to know them that labor among you. How do they live? When a person, see, you got to live God's word to get that understanding of it. Okay? Blessed are the doers of the word and not the hearers only. So the priest's lips to keep knowledge. Where do the priests, where does the priest get his knowledge? Okay, let's find out. Let's go to the book of 2 Timothy. Where should the priest get his knowledge? How is he able to just stand up and say that homosexuality is wrong when you have judges, you have given them given permission to say the same sex can marry each other? When they used to be against the, did you know at one time it used to be against the law for the same sex to marry each other in the United States of America? When people's hearts change and so the laws change, they do what the people want. But I want what God wants. The Bible says what's highly esteemed among men is an abomination in the sight of God. What a lot of people like, God, you can rest assured, God doesn't like it. Because most people, the Bible says how straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leadeth to life. And few there be that find it. See, few people find the right way. But it said broad is the way, broad is the gate, and wide is the way that leadeth to destruction. And many there be that go in thereat. So many people, most people are going to the broad way. So I don't want to go where most people are going. I want to go where the few, the ones that are on that straight and narrow way. That's where I want to go. So as I was saying, how does he just know what's right and what's wrong? Well, let's look and see what the Bible says. See, we have a servant of God that doesn't just make things up, doesn't just come up with something off the top of his head, but he's going to look in that Bible and you can show it to you and you can look into it and you can show it to others. So 2 Corinthians chapter 3, here's what it says, verse 16. Let's start at verse 14. Let's back up a little bit. Verse 10. This is Paul. He said, but thou hast fully known my doctrine. See, do you know their doctrine that you're listening to? What knowledge? Remember, the priest's lips should keep knowledge. The priest ought to be holy, consecrated, set apart for the Lord. Anybody can get up and say some words about the Bible. The serpent did. Satan used the serpent to quote some scriptures. But they were out of context. But look at what Paul told Timothy, a minister. He said, but thou hast fully known my doctrine. And what else? The way I live, my manner of life. Do you know the life of the person that you're following, your priest? How did that person live when they're away from the church? Anybody can dress up and look, put on their church clothes and get a microphone and speak eloquently and say some things out of the Bible. But living the Bible, when there's conflict, when there's odds between family members or relatives or at your house or in the church, what does that person do then? The person that's teaching you. See, this is how you know if somebody is actually godly or not. You can preach and be a pastor, be a bishop, be an apostle, and still be ungodly when you don't do things the way God said to do them. That person, you or whomever it is only godly when they do it the way God said to do it, when they give his instructions for handling matters. But if they just come up with something that's intelligent or intellectual and not according to God's word, that's ungodly. You don't want to follow what they're telling you. You want to follow them or what they're telling you. The Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. The person that's got a title, they're a pastor, whomever. They're intelligent, they're educated, but they do not live God's word. They don't allow God's word to be what governs their life. So look at what Paul said here. He said, you've known my doctrine, You know where I get my teachings from? I just didn't make them up. You know how I live my manner of life. You seen me hurt. You saw how I responded to people that hurt me, that mistreated me, that talked about me. You saw me love them. You saw me praying for them. And when they had need, you saw me extend a hand to them. I didn't treat them the way they treated me. He says, my purpose. See, some people, their purpose is to get a big church to make money. Or their purpose is to just write books so they can get checks. They want to have a revival or a seminar or a workshop to get your dollar bills, not to get your soul saved. See, we're having a revival to get souls saved. We want to see people delivered from sin. We want to see yokes destroyed. We want to see marriages healed. People being able to get along with their husband and their wife. People loving their enemies. Hallelujah. That's why we're praying and fasting. That's what we're going to be praying and fasting for. That damages that were lost during this pandemic be recovered. That souls be saved. We have new hope and new vision. Look at this here. He said, you know my purpose. You know why I have a church. I didn't just make the church on my own, but I was sent by my pastor. I didn't just make up a church on my own. I have a good intention. I want to help some people. Well, helping people is good, but you got to do what God said. If God didn't tell you to help them that way, then you need to get under someone so you can be taught, and perhaps you will be able to lead, but you got to be a follower first. You don't know how to lead if you can't follow first. You got to be humble. Proud people want to just jump out and lead. They want to get in something and be the leader. And they haven't followed. They don't know what to do. Oh, they do something. They say something. It may seem okay, but does it deliver people's souls? Does it cause people to get the victory over the beer bottle, over cursing, over fornication, over the pornography? Over the unforgiveness and the envy. I don't want to just go to church and hear some good sayings of men. Taking some scriptures to use motivational sayings to encourage me in my business. I'll go to college if I want that. Or a business meeting. I go to church to get my soul delivered. I want to know the truth of God's word. How I can have right relationship with my spouse. Even if we're not getting along. Well, what does the Bible tell me to do? That's what I need to know. Not focus on what she's doing, but to look at what God is telling me. If you're at odds with your friend, with your mother, your father, your coworker, what does God's word say to you? You want a shepherd that gives you God's word and not some message from Dr. Phil or Oprah. And I'm not putting them down. They have their respective audience. But when it comes to righteousness and holiness, don't listen to Oprah. Don't listen to Dr. Phil. Don't listen to yourself if it's not what God says. Don't listen to me if it's not written here. See, it's not about you, me, Dr. Phil. It's about what God says in his word. That's what we need to follow. We get his results when we do it his way. Don't listen to the judge or the president or the former president or former presidents. If they tell you something that's not written, we got to stick with God's word. That's why our society is in the condition that it's in. God's word doesn't change. It's forever settled in heaven. Look at what else Paul said, you know, my manner of life, my doctrine, my purpose, faith, what I believe. I'm believing the same thing. Paul's letting them know I didn't get something that was different than what the other apostles got, that we all got from Jesus. The faith that we have, you can search it out. It's line upon line and precept upon precept. Jesus even said this. Jesus said in John, he said, my doctrine is not mine.
You don't just make up some good sayings or what they're telling you. This is what you need to say to them when you're at the seminary. This is what's appropriate. No, what God says is appropriate. This is what needs to be preached in season and out of season. Whether they want to hear it or not, we still got to preach it. And many people don't want to hear it. Some people don't want to hear it, but some do. That's the ones we're going for, the lost sheep. He said, you know my long suffering. See, I've suffered with people. I've suffered a long time with them. Not a short time. I was long suffering with them. Are you long suffering? See, this is charity right here. This is charity. Charity suffers long. Or you want to say love? Same word, charity, love. When you really have the love that God describes, you suffer long. You're not quick-tempered. You're not just ready to put somebody away. But you suffer long with them. You know why? Because God suffered long with you, and is still suffering long with you. You haven't done what God told you to do, and he's still suffering with you. But you know what? He said, I will have mercy on whom I will. Don't try to use God's long-suffering and count that for slackness. Don't try to think you can get over on God. Ananias and Sapphira lied in the midst of the congregation, and they died right there. So you don't want to, you can't out-slick God. He goes on to say, charity. Okay? The love that I have for my enemies, people that mistreat me. He said, you know, my patience, even when things were difficult, I didn't know exactly how they were going to turn out. The way they looked, it was bleak and dim. But I had patience. I still believed God's word, even though things at the time were dark. But I had a favorable outcome. I still believed there was going to be a favorable outcome. I was patient. I persevered. And see, patience is what, when you have that favorable outcome, you're able to move forward. For the joy that was set before him, Jesus endured the cross. You can endure your hardship when you know what God said, how good things are going to await for you, how all things work together for the good of them that love God and are the called according to his purpose. You can go on and still love your enemy because the Bible says all things work together for the good. You know, this is good is going to come from this. Right now, I'm in pain. I'm hurting. I'm being mistreated, but I'm not going to mistreat. I'm being talked about, put down, called out of my name. But you know, the Bible says all things work together for the good. God, I don't know how, but you said it, and you cannot lie. You're not man that you would lie. Lord, you said it's going to work together for my good, and I believe you. I don't believe my feelings. I believe your word. Hallelujah. And you can move forward. The persecutions, he said, the afflictions, you know my pain. People persecuted me, putting me down. I didn't let it stop me, though. He said, which came to me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured. See, I endured these things. But out of them all, look, the Lord delivered me. See, I know you may feel like sometimes that they don't understand the pain that I'm suffering. And Chief spoke about this. He said, sometimes you can feel that you're the only one. You get you know, no one understands exactly what I'm going through. They don't know my wife. They don't know the woman I have to deal with. They don't know my husband, my boss. They don't know how I don't have enough money. So that's why I'm not going to pay my tithes. See, you'll try to justify, use your feelings to justify you disobeying God. You'll feel like you have a need. So it's okay for me to not do what God said. See, Eve thought it was okay to eat that fruit. But just because something may be a need, that doesn't mean you violate God's word to get it. Don't give up your birthright for some food or for whatever your need might be that you may feel. What you really need is God. You think you need some food. You might need some food. You may be hungry, but you need God more than you need the food. One writer said, I esteem your word higher than my necessary food. You got to value God's word. And that's part of the issue. You put other things ahead of God's word. You value what Google says, what Facebook says, or you value how many likes you get on Facebook. You value that more than God's word. And that's why you have the life that you have, the misery and the pain that you have, because you're not putting God's word as priority. But you can put it as priority today. I'm not saying this to put you down, but you got to know how you are. I got to show you your x-ray so you can see your condition. And then you can come out of it. Goes on to say, yea, all that live godly. See, when you live the way God tells you to live, when you don't agree with homosexuality, though you love the homosexual, you love the transgender, but you don't agree with it, you don't get in their parade. Hey, let's have a parade showing our pride that we're homosexual, that we are sodomites. Proud of that. I love how Chief said it. I wouldn't support and be proud with a robber, a fornicator, an adulterer. Why would I be and get in a parade for someone to be proud of being a homosexual, a sodomite? No. I love them though. I'll help them. I'll minister God's word to them. I'm not going to put them away, but I got to tell them what God says. We got to tell them what the word says. They're confused. They don't know. I mean, they change their sex. That's confusion. That's perversion. That's perversion. A pervert. Changing the way God made something. You know, Chief spoke about that. He spoke about how people, God can have an intent when he made something. But because of our desire, we'll change what God made and use it for our intent. That's wicked. They exchange the truth of God for a lie. They'll turn something that God made, they'll turn into something else. God didn't make you to man to lay with another man. He didn't make you woman to lay with another woman. He didn't make you woman, man, to lay with a child. He made them male and female in the book of Genesis. That's what he did. We cannot change what God made something for. We have to use it for the intent. Did you know that's abuse? When you use something for the purpose for which it was not made. And we're going to see that in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And we're going to see what happens when you do things like that. We're talking about the priest's lips keep knowledge so they can instruct and guide God's people in what pleases God. Look at this. It says, yea, verse 12, all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So prepare yourself. Everybody's not going to like you. But God is going to like you. That's the main one I want to like me. So you want other people to get you those likes on Instagram and Facebook. I want God to give me a like. I want to be pleasing to him. I want my conscience clean. Yeah, you told him off, but is your conscience clean? You did what you wanted to do. You cursed him out. You got a temper, but how is your conscience toward God? Is your conscience clean? I want that clean conscience. I want God to like my actions, what I do, not people. But I want God to be pleased with them. He says, But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. See, people are going to get more and more evil. More and more where they are deceiving people. They're seducing people, taking advantage of people, of kids, children. The Bible says they're going to get worse and worse. You're going to have people, phonies, fake preachers, seducing people, getting up in the pulpit, guiding people in sin, telling people it's okay to commit suicide. When God said, thou shalt not kill, that's no one. Don't kill anyone, anybody, not even the body he gave you, because you didn't make that body. God gave it to you. The Bible says your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. So your body is not, wasn't made for you, it was made for God. It was made for him. It wasn't made for you to put drugs in your arm, to drink liquor and get all woozy till you can't guide your body in the right way. That's why you get tickets. That's why even the police officers will give you tickets, because you're being guided by the wrong thing. But you're supposed to be guided by God and his word. And your life will have direction and purpose and meaning when you let God govern your life. God wants to help you. God wants you to come back to him. You may have gotten off track. You may have gone astray. Oh, yeah, you may still go to church. You may still sing in the choir. You may still do things in the church. But where is your heart with God? Do you love him? Does he still excite you? Does holiness excite you? That's what I want to get excited about. Truth, holiness, righteousness, not iniquity. I don't want sin to get me excited, wickedness. God can help you. God can change your heart. He can change your mind, but you got to go before him and tell him, God, I need help. Chief said how you may go through some things in your life where you feel so low and you feel so down, and all you can do is crawl. Well, that's a time to crawl to God. That's a time to get in your closet and just tell God, God, I need help. God, I'm feeling this way, and I know this is against your word. God, help me. Change me. God, I want to witness for you, but I need your power in my life so I can let them know firsthand what you have done for me, how you can do it for them. So you can, God can give you an experience with him. He can help you. He can deliver you. You can glorify God, but God has to first glorify you. He has to help you so you can really represent him to the people. We can't represent him any kind of way. When an ambassador goes to, from of the U.S. goes to another country, they can't represent the U.S. the way they want to do it. They have to follow the guidelines of the U.S. For you to really represent God, you got to follow his guidelines, his word. Not what your pastor said that's not founded on God's word. Not what I say if it's not in here. This is not me saying this. When I'm reading to you, I didn't write this. This is how we represent God, by following what's written here. Santa Claus is not in here. Halloween is not in here. The Easter egg hunt is not in here. So I can't represent God telling you and celebrating that. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to speak the truth. Only the truth is what delivers people. Not what's popular, not what makes people feel good, but truth. God's word is the truth, not man's philosophy or his wisdom, not Aristotle, not these men. It's what God says. Plato, whoever the eloquent and wise people, no, it's God's word. Look at this here. It says, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. Look, deceiving and being deceived. They're going to get deceived too. They're going to deceive people and they're going to be deceived. Verse 14 says, but continue thou in the things that thou hast learned. Where did you, the things that you know, where'd you get them from? Where did you learn what you know? Who taught you this? If it's not, if you can't go to the scriptures, I don't care if it was your grandfather's church, your grandmother's church, that doesn't have anything to do with it. The person, your pastor that you've been going to for 20, 30, 40 years, is he echoing? Is he God's messenger? Is he God's representative? Is he speaking what's written, regardless of how much money you put in the offering bucket, regardless of how many amens he gets? Hopefully, what you learn is you can go to the scriptures and share where you got it from. That's what we're doing tonight. We're showing what God's word says. We're teaching the people of God. We want them to be learned or learned of God. Jesus said how they would come to him if they really learned of him. They all should be taught of God, not of man, but of God. Now, God will use the man that echoes God's word, that lives it first. Because if he doesn't live it, he can't really teach you. How can someone teach you how to fly an airplane just because they read about it in the books? They watch videos about driving the airplane. Would you get in the airplane with them? Would you trust them with your soul? How do they live? Do they have firsthand experience with what they're talking about? You want to follow someone that knows God, that has a relationship with him. They're intimate with him. His word is what governs their thinking, their lifestyle. That's the one that can show you. He said, and has been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. So you got to know who is teaching you. Is it one that God sent or one that just went on his own? I don't want to follow someone that just went. Their purpose is to make money, and they might have a good intent. But that man that reached down to catch the ark when it was falling had a good intent too. But God killed him. See, don't touch things that God told you not to touch. Don't try to get God's word when God and be a pastor when God didn't tell you to be one. You don't just become one on your own. There'll be another servant of God to anoint you or commission you. That's how God did it. That's what he did when he got David to be king. Well, he sent Saul to go and anoint him, or Samuel to go and anoint him. When Saul became king, he sent Samuel to anoint him. When Joshua began to lead the people, well, he had Moses to anoint him. See, that's how God does things. Another servant of God who has walked with God will pass the torch down to the next person. That's someone that sent, not someone that just went. That's how the priest's lips can keep knowledge. When they've been taught by a servant of God, they lived it. They were taught by a servant of God that lived it, and they live it themselves. Look at what he goes on to say, verse 15. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through the faith which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. See, God's word has been inspired. The scriptures have been inspired by God. Yeah, he used a man's hand to write it, but God inspired them. His spirit was upon them, guiding them on what to write. That's the kind of men we need today. If you're going to write a book, it definitely shouldn't contradict this book right here. God's spirit, they should be filled with God's spirit, full of the Holy Ghost, allowing God to lead them. And the Bible speaks about how in the book of Ecclesiastes, it'll be as nails taken and fastened together, and it'll come together and be as one voice. You know how nails, you put nails in something to make something come together and be attached to each other? Well, that's how it'll be when you do write a book. It's not contradicting God's word. A master of assemblies brings it all together, and it's coming from the voice of one shepherd. Line upon line. Nothing contradicting what Paul said, what's in Timothy, what Jesus said, what David said. It'll be line upon line. I mean, people, God is still using men today and women today that live for God. They live holy lives. They live pure lives. Their purpose is not to get money, but it's to bring knowledge and truth to the people. Truth is what delivers. Truth is what is lacking, though we have a lot of churches. We have a lot of telethons on television. You can get some prayer cloths and oil. But what about getting your soul saved? What about being delivered from hatred and prejudice? Hating one person because they're of another political party. You can't even speak to your relative because they believe in a different political party. I mean, you can't even talk to them. You need to be delivered, but you call yourself an evangelical. You go to church. Well, you may call yourself that. Are you holy? God said, be ye holy. He didn't say be an evangelical. He didn't say be a Baptist, be a Catholic. He said, be holy. For I am holy. See, we get caught up in names and titles, and we forget them, and we lose sight of what God, the name that God wants us to be. He goes on to say this, verse 16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine. This is where you should get doctrine from the scriptures. This is why we can say homosexuality is wrong, even though a judge or the judges vote and the people, many people say it's okay when God condemns it. Did you know that they even have, I saw a TED talk, a popular platform that people use to try to convey knowledge. But remember, the Bible says the priest's lips should keep knowledge. Well, they're giving out knowledge too on these TED talks. And a priest and a nun were up there justifying homosexuality. You can go and look at this yourself. Justifying. The reason why they said God destroyed, they went to the Bible. The reason why they said God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah was because of them not being hospitable to the angels. No, sir. But that's why you got to go to the priest that's been sent by God. Anybody can say, I want to be a priest or I want to be a nun. But did God send you to be a leader of the people? Have you been taught by another servant of God like Joshua? Joshua just didn't get up and lead the people. He followed the servant of God. What servant of God is leading you? Who are you assisting? So you can learn how to be a leader, but you first have to serve. To serve, you got to be humble, but you're proud. You want to have your name in lights. You want to be seen. Well, God needs to be seen, not you. That's why you got to be careful where you're getting your knowledge from. Who's teaching you? Where are they getting their doctrine from? We see here, and we're going to go to it in a minute, but I want you to know how chief you, me, can stand up and say with love, but we can say with confidence when something is wrong, because we're getting it from the scriptures. It says also the scripture is profitable for reproof. You can correct things. You can point out where it's got something missing. Okay, it says for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Not in what's popular, in righteousness. That's what we want to do. We want to get to the scriptures. It says that the man of God, see, the man of God, may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Okay? Now let's go to the book of Leviticus. Go to the book of Leviticus, chapter 18. Okay, I'm going to the scripture. I didn't make this up. I didn't write it. But I'm a messenger. I speak his message. I don't come up with my own message. Not to please the judges, the president. To please God. Leviticus 18. It says in verse 22. Thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. Why? It is abomination. It's detestable. It's disgusting. That's what abomination means. Okay? Did you know that lying is an abomination too? See, don't just look at the homosexual. Are you a liar? That's an abomination. Are your feet quick to run to mischief, where there's strife and confusion and division? That's an abomination too. I'm not here to put the homosexual down. I'm here to give instruction in righteousness. Look at what it says. Verse 23, neither shalt thou lie with any beast. You may be wondering, why is that in the Bible? Because people were doing that, and people do it today. Why are laws made? Why do they make laws? Because people are doing that, and they want to make it a violation. They want to stop that. So people were doing it then, and people do it now. People will come up with all kinds of things. You don't know how far sin will take you. The Bible says a little leaven will leaven the whole lump. We don't want a little leaven around here. A little sin, no sin. The Bible says how sinners will not get to heaven. It said that in the book of Peter. It says how the righteous shall scarcely be saved. If the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and sinner appear? The unrighteous person is not getting to heaven. So you might be saying, that's the Old Testament. Okay, let's go to the New Testament then. You need to know what's in the Old Testament so you can understand the New Testament. And see what's in the New Testament, you see a lot of it came from the Old Testament. If you search the scriptures, you'll see it wasn't just made up. Paul wasn't just making things up. Jesus went to the Old Testament. And he came to give understanding and take it, not only that it just be law, but that it on the tables of stone, but that it be written on the fleshy tables of the heart. He came to write it in your mind and in your conscience, that you don't just say, well, I don't do that, but do you think about it? So you may not commit adultery physically, but you can look upon a woman to lust after her, and you commit adultery in your heart. If you hate your brother, you're a murderer. So you may not have murdered someone physically, yet if you don't get that murder out of your heart, because that's what called this you to do it. Let's go to Romans chapter, 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Okay, look at this, verse 9. It says, don't you know Or know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Paul is saying, you don't know that? Don't you know that? See, you've let lying preachers, false preachers, ones that were not sent by God, lie to you and trick you, making you think you can live a sinful, wicked life. You can practice sin and still get to heaven. The Bible says he that is born of God does not commit sin. That's what the Bible says in the Epistle of John. When you are born of God, when you've been born again, you don't practice sin. Let's say you did sin. You don't make it a practice, though. When it's brought to your attention, when the man of God shows you what's instruction in righteousness, when he shows you the reproof or the correction about that, the correct way, you repent. You repent of it. You turn from it. That's what sheep do. Sheep, when they hear that voice of their shepherd, it makes them respond to him. I want to be a sheep. Hopefully that's your intent too. Even if you've been a goat prior to hearing this message, you can be a sheep right now. Have a mind to say, God, change me. I'm tired of rebelling against your word, doing what I think, not submitting to the counsel. See, some people, they get tired of somebody counseling them because their counselor keeps saying the same thing. Well, you keep not doing it. So that you want them to change the message. No, you need to change. God's word doesn't change. You need to change. This is what's going to give you the peace that you're looking for. Not a man, not a woman. I need a man. No, you need Jesus. You need to be delivered. He wants to be your bridegroom. That's what you can be. Married and still be empty and lonely and in pain. Don't fool yourself. That's happening. But God wants you to be married to him. He said, I'm married to you, Israel. He says, be not deceived. Don't be tricked. Don't let people trick you. Study God's word. Study it. Don't just read it. Study it. Look up other passages. I just showed you in the Old Testament. I'm going to show you in the New Testament. Condemning the same practice. Even though this priest and this nun got on the TED Talk and told you it's okay to be homosexual. God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah because they were inhospitable. That's a lie from the devil. I don't care if you have a black jacket and the little white part, doesn't matter what you have. If you're not speaking God's word, that's wrong. The Bible says how they can be in sheep's clothing. They can look like a sheep and be a wolf. Be not deceived, neither fornicators. You're fornicating, that's all unlawful sexual activity. That's homosexuality. That's oral sex, that's anal sex, that's fornication, that's against God. I don't care if you're married. Don't you know the Bible says how marriage is honorable and the bed undefiled? That's in Hebrews chapter 10. It says, but whoremongers and adulterers, God will judge. See, there's even certain guidelines, certain doctrine, certain teachings, even for married people. God didn't make everything that he made to do what you want to do with it. He made it for what he made it for. Don't change the purpose for which he made something. That's abuse. He said, so fornicators, pornography, twosomes, threesomes, all this stuff, swinging, it's fornication, and they're all going to hell, according to the Bible. The Bible says all fornicators will have their part in the lake that burneth with fire and brimstone. That's in Revelation. He says, nor idolaters. You value yourself over God. You idolize yourself, your hair, your body. You serve yourself more than the Creator. Nor adulterers, nor effeminate. See, he doesn't want any effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. If you look that word up, that phrase, abusers of themselves with mankind, look it up in the Greek. Get you a strong concordance, study, you're going to see it's a sodomite. And a sodomite is someone that lays, a male that lays with another male as he does with a woman. Okay? So you see that there. Nor thieves, if you're a thief, you don't pay your tithe, you rob God, you take what God has given you. He gave you the health to do it, and you don't even pay your tithe. You don't even honor him. 10 cents out of a dollar, you're stingy. You're full of yourself. You're proud. It's all about you. You want to be the center of attention. But God is trying to help you. He's not trying to condemn you. He doesn't want any to perish. But you have to know your condition. I got to show you the x-ray so you can see what is acceptable in the sight of God and what is not. Yeah, you say, I got to pay my light bill. Well, what about those other bills that you created? You went and got a car that was above what you could pay. You bought a house that was above, or an apartment that was above that you could pay. When you made your budget, you didn't even have the tithes on the top. You put on there your new shoes or your new dress or this car. See, that's not the type of heart. That's not the type of person that's going to get to heaven. He said, nor covetous. So you want what somebody else, what belongs to someone else. You want their husband, their wife. You want their car. Get you a job. Go to college. Study. Work. Stop being lazy. And also save. Don't spend everything you make. Pay your tithes. Pay your pledge. See, God will bless you. So we can establish more churches. Be faithful. God will move for you. And see, God, I haven't talked to anybody but God. He knows, the Bible says God knows your thoughts. It says how God's word is the discerner of the thoughts and the intents. He can discern your intent for why you said something. It says how everything is open and naked before him. He sees it for what it is. He can see your spirit, what other people don't readily see. It says, nor drunkards. See, you want to get drunk and think you're going to heaven. No, the Bible says we're not to even touch the wine. The Bible says in Revelation how God has made us all kings and priests to our God. Then in Proverbs it says how it's not for kings and priests to drink wine, to not even drink it. I don't want to drink it. No, I don't need it with some cheese. And I've been to France. I didn't want no wine with the cheese. No, sir. I don't want to be drunk with wine, but I want to be filled with the Spirit. I don't have to have a glass of wine to feel comfortable. I want to get in the Spirit to feel comfortable. The Bible says the Spirit, which is the comforter, the Holy Ghost, which is the comforter. That's what comforts me, not a cigarette, not some other lady that I'm not married to, not my ex-wife, my ex-boyfriend. No. The Holy Ghost is the comforter. You need the Holy Ghost. You need God's Spirit living on the inside of you and guiding you. Not what you watched on the plate, looked in the Playboy magazine, the hustler, the pornography, or what somebody taught you. Do this to him. No, sir. The Bible says God is the God of all comfort. If it's not of God, then that's not true comfort. It says, and revilers. You always got something to say back. You need to hold your peace, as the Bible says. It says how a soft answer will turn away wrath. But you want to revile. You want to rise up and show them how loud you can get. No, you need to repent. Let God fight your battles, not you fight your battles, nor extortioners getting money through deceitful ways, cheating on your taxes, shall inherit the kingdom of God. None of these individuals, these lifestyles, are getting to heaven. This is in the Bible. Now, watch the type of Bible you're reading, because they take certain things out of different types of Bibles. That's why I like sticking with the King James, because it's word for word. It was translated word for word. Don't change it. Don't take one word out. It goes on to say this, verse 11, and such were some of you. See, I was a fornicator. I used to be. Not now, though. None of us should be any of these. None of us should still be getting drunk. None of us should still be revilers, idolaters, covetous, abusers of ourselves with mankind, fornicators, effeminate. We shouldn't be that. That's past tense, were. And such were some of you, but ye are washed. See, God can wash your conscience. He can give you a new mind. He can purge your conscience and cause things that used to bother you to be washed from you. That's what he can do. That's the power that comes from the Spirit of God. That's why you don't just need religion. You need the power of God, which comes through the Spirit of God. Okay. But you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus. How? And by the Spirit of our God. The Spirit is what makes you right in the sight of God. It says, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. So though I have liberty to do, I can watch TV, I can go to the baseball game, I can go to the football game, I can go to the track meet. Look at what he says, though. He says, but all things are not expedient. When I need to pray, I don't need to go to the football game. When I'm supposed to be at church, I don't need to go to the baseball game. That's not expedient for me. It's not good for me. It's not helpful to me. I need to be in my closet. He said, all things are lawful, but all, he said, all things are lawful for me, but I would not be brought under the power of any. We're going to go on a fast Thursday. Don't be brought under the power of food. Food, you know, that we need that. But don't let food have control over you. Push that plate away and fast. Go before God. Sanctify yourself. Separate yourself. Get in prayer. Get in the Word. Put on Alexander Scorby. Listen to the Bible speaking to you. Have it playing while you're walking around in your house. Turn on Chief preaching. Bishop King preaching. Bishop Wilson telling you to have a not just prayer activity, but a prayer life. That after you get up from praying, your life is now framed by what you prayed about. You live it. Versus being like the Pharisee that prayed long prayers, prayed a long time, but they didn't change. So people can pray for a long time and still not change. Bishop Wilson said he's seen people pray for a long time and get up and go right back and do the thing that they prayed against. Go right back and do the thing that was displeasing to God. I don't want to pray like that. I don't want to pray in vain. I want to pray like the Pharisee in the book of Luke chapter 18. He spoke about how he tithed of all that he possessed. He fasted twice a week. See, you can fast and still not do it the right way. Because this man's prayer was not accepted by God. It only went up to the ceiling. So just because you pray and fast and pay tithes, where's your heart? Why are you doing these things? To be seen so you can brag? No, sir. You have a good voice. It's not for you to go around saying, I got a good voice. It's for you to glorify God. It's so that yokes can be broken in the lives of people. People can repent by hearing God through you, you being anointed of him. Not for you can get your own record label. Not so people can know about you and buy your CDs. It's so souls can be saved. It's so that God's kingdom can come in earth as it is in heaven. Your song should be about the kingdom, not about what everybody wants to hear. We can all make books and sing songs and preach about what the people want to hear and get lots of followers. But that's not what's acceptable in the sight of God. We want to sing spiritual songs. The Bible tells us what to sing in the book of Colossians and also in Ephesians chapter 5. It says, sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Something spiritual is from the Spirit. And when it's of the Spirit, it's always going to lead you into God's word. Just because they talk about Jesus doesn't mean it's spiritual. They can sing about Jesus and make you want to move just like they move in the clubs. As many songs do that. But when it's spiritual, it'll make you want to please God. It'll make you repent when it's spiritual. When it's of God, it's going to bring God's results. It's going to give you the results from this Bible. So it's not about pleasing the people. It's about pleasing God. Let's go to Romans chapter 1. And we'll start at verse 21. It says, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. See, you can know God and don't give him the glory. Don't give him the due praise and credit for what how he's using you. It's not you, it's him through you. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful. They don't, when they pray, they don't thank God. They don't appreciate him. They don't thank him for waking them up, for providing health and food, a job, but just complain and I don't have this, God. I want a bigger house. Not, Lord, thank you that I can walk. God, I can see. I may not have a job right now, God. But I know when I get one, when you bless me with one, tithes is what I'm paying and offering and my pledge. That's probably why you don't have one, because you haven't, that's not your intent. You want to get you cars and houses and some weave and or some, and I'm not saying weave is bad, but what about paying your tithes? You want to get you a fishing rod. You want to buy some tickets to the football game or the basketball game. Not, those are not necessarily sin. But if they come before God, they are. You're not paying your tithe, but you spend $100 on some tickets. You're robbing. You're a robber, and you're not getting to heaven. Though you are in church, and you have an office in church. You do things in church, even in Refuge Temple. You're going to hell when you violate God's word. The priest's lip has to keep knowledge. I got to tell you what the Bible says. That's because I care about you. I don't want you to go to hell. Look at this here. It says, neither were thankful. It's so important to be thankful. It's so important to be thankful. Not just at Thanksgiving. Every day. God didn't have to let me live. It's people dying on the freeways. I was talking to my aunt, and she was telling me, this man was just driving on the road, and all of a sudden he felt his leg full of heat. Blood was coming out of his leg. He got shot. Didn't even know it. Driving on the road. So you need to be thankful. If you make it home, You made it to church. You made it to work. Be thankful. You woke up. You have food to eat. Many, you're not fleeing Ukraine. You don't have bombs being dropped in your neighborhood. Someone trying to steal in your property. Just like Putin, President Putin, he's removing the landmark that was set of old. That's wrong. That's against God. The Bible says remove not the landmark that was set of old. It's not right for me to go and just say, you know what, give me your house. I want this house, and I bomb your house for it. No, that's evil. That's wicked. And that's wicked what he's doing. I'm getting this from the Bible. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, and instruction in righteousness in what's right. It's going to show you what's wrong. Look at what he goes on to say. Neither were thankful, but became vain. See, when you don't glorify God, when you're not thankful, when you don't appreciate him, and not just saying it with words, when you're thankful, your lifestyle will reflect gratitude by pleasing him, by living in obedience to his word. That's the way you can thank him, by doing what he told you to do. You don't have to try to give him a gift or say some nice words, like you try to say some nice words to your wife, but your actions contradict what you say. You're supposed to reverence your husband, but your actions contradict it. But you say you're godly. You say you're godly, but you mistreat the person on your job that mistreated you. The Bible says, love your enemy. Do good to them that hate you. Bless them that curse you. And pray for them that despitefully use you and say all manner of evil against you falsely. You're a Christian. You're supposed to follow Christ. These are his teachings. It says, but became vain. You can become vain in your imaginations, in what goes on in your mind. It doesn't profit you. And their foolish heart was darkened. A foolish heart. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. So you might not say it out loud with your mouth, but in your heart, you're saying it. And it's reflected by the way you live. If you knew there was a God, you wouldn't be lying. Because all liars will have their part that burns with fire in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone. Your foolish heart was darkened, became just darkened, full of sin, full of iniquity in church. But God can deliver you. He can recover you. He can revive you. I want to encourage you to come to the revival. Even tonight, you can be revived. You can be revived and you can take the revival to the revival. You can tell other people about it. God can revive you now. If I can get you to believe and have a mind to please him in every aspect of your life, he can revive you right now. He can cause you to live again and your life have purpose and meaning and you be fulfilled being single. He can fulfill you. Did you know that godliness with contentment is great gain? That's whether you're married or single. You can be content being godly, being pure. He says, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man and to birds. They began to make images. They gave themselves to these things over God. To birds and to four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore, see, when you do that, look at what God's going to do. See, you do that, and this is what the consequence. And you chose to do it through the lust of your own heart. Through those vile affections, those evil, wicked affections. Every affection that you have is not of God. If it's against what's written here, it's vile. And you need to see it as that. It says, wherefore, also, verse 24, God gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Dishonoring your body. You're doing things that are dishonorable, bringing shame to you. Bringing shame to your children because you dishonor your own body. God didn't make your body for you to just do any old thing with it. He made your body for the temple of the Holy Ghost. Look at verse 25. Who changed the truth of God into a lie. People want to hear a lie from a preacher versus the truth. But remember, Jesus said in John chapter 8, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. That's why you see a lot of people not free today from sin, because they don't hear the truth and they don't respond to it. You got to hear it first. But in this church and in this revival, you're going to get the truth. You have a chance to be free. God's going to help you. He wants you to have a relationship with him. He wants you to be married, intimate with him. Spirit, your spirit receiving his spirit, that marriage, that union. He said, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. You serve yourself. You're the creature, or your husband or your wife or your children. You can serve them more than God. And look at what else will happen when you do that. Verse 26. For this cause, God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. That's against nature. For a woman to lay with another woman. It's against nature. Do you see two dogs doing that? Two cows? I'm not talking about ones that they twisted or tamed to do that. You see 20 dogs chasing one dog? Those 20 are chasing that one that's of a different gender. But today, man has become so intellectual, they change their gender. The man wants to become a woman and the woman a man. Such perversion. If you read Deuteronomy chapter 23, you'll see that the Bible says, he that is wounded in the stones and cut off his privy member shall not enter into the congregation of the Lord. That's in the Bible. You cut off your privy member, your genitalia, the Bible says you can't even enter into the congregation of the Lord. This is God's word. It doesn't matter what any judge says or how many people, if all the majority, even if the Democrats, Republicans, the independents, all of them get together and say, this is what we want. And God says something different. That's the majority. God is the majority. We got to stick with his word. That's why our society is so stressed out, filled with so much tension and hatred, because God's word has no place in their hearts. But they go to church. They talk about the Bible. But the word is not in them. They don't have the spirit of God dwelling inside of them. The kingdom is not in them. Look at this. It says, verse 27, and likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of a woman. See, God gave the woman for the man, not the man for the man, not the woman for the woman. Burned in their lust. They just start being driven by this lust, one toward another. Men with men. Working that which is unseemly. See, when something is unseemly, it's shameful. It's not appropriate. It's not right. That's a shame to see two men kissing each other, hugging. full of lust for each other. That's a shame. That's unseemly. That is an abomination. We read that in Leviticus chapter 18. I didn't write this. I'm the messenger. Don't get mad at me. I'm telling you the truth out of love for you. He says, and look at what happens. When you choose to just be driven of your own lust, look at this. He said, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet, or which was due to them. God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah because of that wickedness, of that sin. The whole city was given over to it, the Bible says. They wanted to lay with those angels. They said, we want to know them, meaning they want to have sex with them. Like Adam knew Eve, and she bare him a son. They wanted to know those angels. That's how wicked and driven with lust they were. Verse 28. And even as they did not like to retain God, so you got to retain him in your knowledge. You got to keep what his word says in your knowledge. The priest's lips have to keep knowledge. I'm talking about the knowledge of God, not the knowledge of the professors, the doctor so-and-so, who's written so many books and published this many articles. I don't want to hear that when it comes to my soul being saved. When it comes to righteous instruction in righteousness in God, what's right in his eyes. They did say 28, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over. We've been seeing God giving people over because of what they did. See how he'll suffer along with you, but if you keep doing it and you don't repent, he'll give you over to it. He'll give you over to it. Did you know in the book of John, chapter 13, the Bible says how the devil, having put it into Judas's heart to betray Jesus. See, you can think about something. Satan can bring something to you. And you say, you know what? I agree with that. And then it enters into your heart. If a thought comes to you that the devil brings to you and you reject it, that didn't get in your heart. You rejected it. So I don't care if a thought came to you and you got the heebie-jeebies. You got a feeling that you used to get when you did used to do that evil thing. But if you rejected that thought and say, I don't agree with that. No, sir, I'm not doing that. That's the old me. That's the one that I buried when I got baptized. That's the one when I repented. Then you're not guilty, even though you got the heebie-jeebies. Because you rejected that thought. You casted it down. So remember that. Don't let the devil condemn you. But you bring every thought captive and make it obedient to Christ. As it said in Corinthians, it says, God gave them over to a reprobate mind, a mind that just does debased, shameful, wicked, dishonorable things. He'll give you that type of mind to do those things which are not convenient. Things that are not right, that are not fitting, that are not appropriate in his eyes. Things that are not righteous in his eyes. Being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, always got something to say back. Deceit, malignity, whisperers, always talking about people. See, all that is evil too. That's against God as well, just like homosexuality. It says backbiters. You talk about people behind their back. See, that you're going to hell too. See, we come against all sin because God is against all sin. I want to feel just like my father. I want to be his son. I want to be just like my daddy. I want to have the same hatred for all sin like he does. And I want to love righteousness like he does and love people. I love the transgender. I love the homosexual. I'm not trying to hurt them. I love the rapist, but I got to tell all of them the truth. I got to tell them what God loves. I got to tell them his word. He honors his word. Being filled with backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things. People are inventing evil, coming up with all kind of evil stuff, vaping and just all kind of stuff. Man, I got this new drug. Let me put some fentanyl with this, man. Killing people. Just all kind of stuff people are inventing. Without understanding, covenant breakers, they just dishonor their word. Without even natural affection, don't love their kids, kill their kids, leave them in apartments for a year. Let the other kids be present with them. Go into schools and just shoot up little kids. Without natural affection. This is what happens when God's word is not in the heart of people. I'm not just talking about laws. I'm talking about God's word getting in the heart. They can make all kind of laws for you to not do this and not do that. But until God's word is written in your heart, you can quote it all day. Listen to it on the radio, Alexander Scorby. It's got to get in your heart. As I told you, how Satan, the devil, put it into Judas' heart to betray Jesus. But Judas accepted it. He accepted the thought. And then you know what happened? The Bible says how Satan entered into Judas. See, Satan began, Judas began, he accepted the thought and just embraced it. It became his own. And he just began to just embrace it, to ponder it, plan it. He wanted that silver. And then Satan entered into him. See, if you take God's word, let God put it into your heart, and you meditate on it, think about it, about doing it, God will enter into you and possess you. And you'll be possessed by God, being led by his spirit, just like Satan did it to Judas. And what happened? Judas did what those swine did, ran off a cliff. But when God is governing you, you'll love your enemy. You'll bless the ones that curse you. You'll be godly. And you can be that way. Clap your hand for Jesus. Praise God for our chief apostle, our bishops, our senior pastor, our prophetess, our evangelists, our handmaidens, deacons, our carpet cleaners, the restroom cleaners, the one that cut the grass. Praise God for each and every individual. Hallelujah. Because we all are important. No one person is higher than the other. You hear our chief say it, that he's not more important than the one that cleans the toilets. See, we all are to be humble. We're all brethren. God is so good for giving us a shepherd like that. I'm thankful that God has blessed us with a true servant of God. And we should not be just thankful with our mouth, but we should be thankful with our pocketbooks. And bless our chief. Cash App him. Cash App our chief. Yes, sir. Let him know you appreciate him while he's living, because he almost didn't make it. But God loved us enough to put that angel in the water, to strengthen Sister Fawn so she could pick him up, and those men could come and get with the ambulance and the gurney and get him to safety. And God, over time, healed him from being broken into pieces, his different parts of his vertebrae. Couldn't even brush his teeth. Couldn't throw a ball straight. But now he can get up and preach for hours. He can do push-ups. Glory to God. That's because of God's love for us. God gave that apostle for the perfecting of us, for the saints. But let's appreciate our apostle. He's our apostle. He may not be an apostle to the world, but he's our apostle. Let's appreciate our apostle. Hallelujah. Thank God for each of you being with us. Thank God for our chief apostle. Thank God for Sister Fawn, her commitment, her service to God, and to our chief apostle, nurturing him to health. Thank God for each one of you. I want to share with you that, remember, we have a revival coming up. And tomorrow, we wake up fasting. We're not eating any food. I know some of you may be, you may take medication and you may need to eat some food just so you can take the medication. Not to get full, not to eat a meal. Okay, just enough for you to take your medication. God will honor that. Also, for you that you may be lost my train of thought, but we're fasting tomorrow, okay? And so we're going to wake up fasting, and we are going to be praying for God to do the things that he saves souls, that he restores what the damage that has been done during the pandemic. So we want God to move for us. We want him to start a new beginning within each one of us. Why? So we can finish the work on the earth, so we can colonize the earth for him. We have a job to do. Refuge Temple has the truth. And so we have to spread this throughout the earth. That's why our finances are needed. We want to also, during this fast, we want to meditate and pray for those that have gone astray and have gotten weak, to be restored, to be renewed, to be revived. Our nation needs to be revived. We want everyone to be praying these things. Amen. So that's this. Tomorrow is the fast. And we'll be fasting until Friday morning when we wake up. Also, we will have the revival starting Friday night at 7:15 p.m. outdoors. Invite others. You can invite them through the handbill, through the digital copy that we have hanging up. You can pass that around. And we also have a video that you can share with others as well. Now, for this revival, if you are experiencing the flu, allergies, or COVID-like symptoms, sneezing, sore throat, runny nose, cough, or fever, please do not come to the revival. I know you want to hear that word, but you can hear it at home. We want to be mindful because love is concerned about the other. You don't want to pass that along to someone else. So you can still get blessed. You just remain home and watch it online. And masks are strongly encouraged, the KN95 masks. Okay? And if it's possible, please test yourself before attending. We want to make sure that everyone is not in a condition to where they can pass on it to others. And due to the heat, that's another thing I wanted to say, make sure you're hydrated. Make sure you're staying hydrated during the fast. You're drinking plenty of water. Start doing that now. Get your body right and get your mind right to fast. Get something from God. Get in a spiritual mindset. Get focused. Okay? We want to prevent hydration, so bring your own water to the revival. Okay? Also, if we're going to have translation at the revival as well, so you know those that speak Spanish, los que hablan español, pueden invitarles. You can invite them. Because we want that word to go in Spanish as well. Encourage them, if they have a earpiece, to bring that as well. They can bring their own earpiece and we'll have the transmitter for them. And someone will be translating the message. Also, know that we have our weekly announcements. Sunday morning, we have our service at... tonight's Bible study is online, 7 p.m. And then on Monday, we have sisterhood meeting online at 7 p.m. Wednesday, we have interactive Bible study online, 7 p.m. And then Sunday, new members class at 8:50, that's online. The Sunday school, we will not have Sunday school because our gym area is going to be filled with equipment. And so we won't have Sunday school this Sunday. Morning service at 10 a.m. Make sure you're paying attention to the group me's, the messages, and they'll be announcing it even at the revival about Sunday morning. Then Sunday night service is online. Now, we have our weekly broadcast stream on Facebook and YouTube. That comes on Monday through Friday at 1 p.m. and then Saturday at noon. And then we have altar prayer daily at noon. And then we also have a radio broadcast that comes on 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, starting at 5 a.m. to 5:30, and then again at 9:30 to 10, and then again at 8:30 p.m. to 9. This is all on KKHT and FM radio station. But if you're outside of that listening area, you can go to KKHT or ChristianRadio.com, and you can still hear it at those same times. Amen. Our marketing team, media team has done a great job. We've been having the revival echoed on the radio. You may have seen it on the news or on the channel 11, different channels on the TV. It's been announced on KKHT, so praise God. We're looking for a great turnout. We're looking for souls to be saved. And remember those things, damage to be, that's happened from the pandemic to be restored. And we want to be renewed on the inside of us so we can finish the work that God has for us in the earth. Remember paying your tithes. This is how this is able to happen. We just can't ask CenterPoint to keep our lights on because we believe in holiness. They need the money. Okay, so we need to pay our tithe. And plus, that's part of being a sheep. You're doing what God tells you to do. You can pay online. You don't have to come to the church physically to pay your tithe. If you just text to 77977, text this, RTMINC, and you'll receive some instructions on how to pay your tithe. And if you haven't paid your pledge, encourage you to pay that. Pay it in increments, or if you have it all, you can pay that as well, because we want to buy this property for this church in Monroe. We want them to hear in Monroe, Louisiana, the same truth that a light has sprung up. And you want to have an area that can house the people, and they still have this McDonald-type. My point is, just like at any McDonald's you go to, you can get a Big Mac. Well, Refuge Temple, like over here, will be like it is over there. Okay? So we need our funds to come together as one. Amen? So if we will now conclude in a word of prayer. So if you'll bow your heads with me in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your word, that we don't have to be ignorant or come up with our own thoughts, but we can look to your word, God, to show us what's right and what's wrong. To show, because your word, God, is profitable for reproof, for correction, for doctrine, for instruction in righteousness. God, we appreciate you for giving us your word. And God, for giving us a messenger, our chief apostle, God, to stand up boldly and uncompromisingly, unwavering, preaching it. God, help us, God, to appreciate your love for us by giving him to us, his sacrifice, God, his life, God, from a young man, been committed to fulfill the purpose that you put him on the earth. And God, now we have a purpose. And it has come from your word that you've given to your messenger. Just like in the book of Samuel, God, when the word was rare, they had no open vision. But Lord, we have the word. We have open vision. We can see. We know your purpose for us in the earth. It's not to be a doctor or a lawyer or a teacher, even though these things are good. But our purpose, God, is to please you, to do your will exactly the way it is in heaven. God, be glorified in us. Live in our bodies. Deliver us from all evil. Let no evil be in us, O God. Purify us, God. Purge us from all sin. Purge our conscience. Give us a new conscience, God. God, bless every one of us during this fast. Help us all to stay hydrated and to stay spiritually minded, to stay focused, God. God, that souls be saved, that lives be restored and renewed. God, that what has been damaged during the pandemic has been restored. oh God. Help us to finish the purpose, God, the vision that you've given our chief apostle, God, to take this gospel throughout the earth where holiness is for all people, all nations. The mountain of the Lord's house will be established in the top of the mountains, and how all nations will flow unto it. Oh God, we appreciate you for just being a part of it. Help us, God, to render all of our resources, our energy, our time for your purpose, God. We thank you. We appreciate you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. And we're greeting one another with a holy kiss, but from a distance.